can make me pure again.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Found I owe nothing but the blood of Jesus. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood.
There's power in the blood, power in the blood.
Would your evil a victory win?
There's wonderful power in the blood.
There is power, power,
wonder-working power
in the blood of the Lamb.
There is power, power,
wonder-working power
in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow?
There's power in the blood.
Stains are lost in which life-giving flow.
There's wonderful power in the blood.
There is power, power,
wonder-working power
in the blood of the Lamb.
There is power, power,
wonder-working power
in the precious blood of the
Hi, welcome to Pilgrim's Progress. I'm Ray Greenlee, pastor of the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. Thank you for joining me today for this broadcast about Jesus. I asked someone this past week, "Are you interested in Jesus?" I am. Any friendship, any relationship that I have, Jesus is the base of that friendship. Without him, I have nothing. Now, Sunday, after I spoke to the congregation, I stood at the pulpit after the benediction with tears in my eyes. And I said, "Lord, how can your people ever be delivered from the bondage therein? How can they ever be turned toward you with such power, with such conviction, that they'll leave behind the shackles of their life, that they'll turn aside from the misery that the devil has put upon them and in their hearts? Will they ever turn aside from the hurt they have, from the anger Will they ever stop running long enough for your precious blood to heal them, to restore them? You see, we've spoken on this broadcast about a fundamental truth found in Romans, the 8th chapter, where it says the sinful nature is hostile to God. That the sinful nature can't please God. Well, that word for sinful in the Greek is carnal. Carnality always has with it a sense of uncleanness. Every time Jesus cast a demon out as he was walking on the earth, he always referred to it as an unclean spirit. Everything about the devil is unclean. And he catches us in these cages. And we become comfortable in the cage in which we dwell. And God tries to open something new for us, and we're afraid of it. So we shy away. We don't understand it. There is freedom in Jesus. I've noticed a strange thing. Sometimes when I've spent a lot of time with Jesus in my prayer closet and in the scriptures, and I come out, the whole world looks dark and coarse. It looks unclean. And then somehow as I'm out about and living in it, it loses some of that darkness because my eyes have become accustomed to the darkness. But as soon as I get back in the prayer closet, as soon as I begin to read the scriptures, there is such a call for refinement and beauty and peace and joy. The power of Jesus just begins to totally destroy all of the darkness that tries to press in on me. Sometimes in the worship service, I've watched as visitors come in, and visitors are always welcome. But I've noticed sometimes that as visitors come in, they bring confusion. They bring with them the spirit they've been walking in. They bring with them the darkness that is about their lives. And I praise Jesus as they come in, the light is present. And I stand by faith that the darkness can never overcome the light, that the light of Jesus is sufficient to dispel the darkness. I remember when I was just a child, one Christmas, my mother and father gave me a flashlight. Now, I was always afraid of the dark as a small child. And Mom and Dad were very stern about this. You did not leave your bed and go climb in bed with them. No, you stayed in your bedroom with your brother. And I would sometimes be awake at early hours of the morning, and I would see strange shapes, and I would become so terrified, I'd shut my eyes and pull the covers over my head. So Mom and Dad gave me a flashlight for Christmas. And Dad said to me, "Ray, when you're afraid, just turn on the flashlight. And when the flashlight comes on, the darkness will run away, and you will see the reality for what it is." I've never forgotten that truth. I love that flashlight. I finally wore it out. It's hard to wear a flashlight out. But I would shine that light up on the curtains and in corners and under my bed. I'd lean over my bed and under it, and I'd shine that flashlight to make sure there wasn't any nightmare under there. Well, I found dust kitties, but nothing scary. See, when we turn the light on, we see reality for what it is, and then we don't have to be afraid anymore. It's when we're in the dark that we become afraid. Jesus is the light. And as we come into his presence, that light will break the bondage. The problem comes when we are comfortable in our bondage and we don't want to risk moving out of our bondage into something new that God is trying to give to us. I'd like to share a story with you from the Old Testament, and then we're going to move forward to the book of Hebrews today. Very quickly, I'm going to give you the phone number in studio. If you'd like to call, I'd be happy to talk with you, and I'd be happy to pray with you. The phone number is 877-534-0780. That number again, 877-534-0780. If you know today that you are in the dark, that you are held in bondage, and you're afraid, and you don't know what to do, then call and let's talk about it and pray about it. The answer that I'm going to give you, though, is going to be very simple. Turn to Jesus, and as you turn to him, the light will go on, because he is the light. And everything you're afraid of will be seen for what it really is. And it won't be scary anymore. But let me share a story with you. The children of Israel had been brought out of slavery, cruel slavery, where they had been beaten, mistreated, their babies killed. They'd been brought out of Egypt with a mighty, powerful hand of God. Egypt was, at that point, one of the great centers of civilization. The children of Israel had been kept pushed down in bondage. They had almost totally lost their confidence in God. But they were still crying out to him for deliverance. And according to the promise given to Abraham, they were brought out of that place by the hand of God. You remember the story as they moved forward into the desert, they came to the Red Sea. And they crossed over on dry land. The Egyptians tried to follow them, and they were killed as the waters crashed in on top of them and drowned them. Now the children of Israel are in the wilderness. Now please understand, every Christian is going to be led through trying, difficult, testing times. Anyone who sets their heart on pilgrimage to follow Jesus will go through what is called in the scriptures the Valley of Baca. Baca in the Hebrew means weeping. Because it's necessary for every one of us to understand the conditions of this world and to become sufficiently upset with what's happening in our lives that we finally turn to Jesus and say, Jesus, rescue me, help me, deliver me. If that would not happen, if Jesus allowed us to simply live out a comfortable lifestyle as many in America are doing, they will never turn to him. A young man knelt with me on Sunday after the message. The church had been dismissed. People were standing around talking. And a young man came to me. A young man who had been a Hindu. He came to me and he said, what do I have to do to follow Jesus? And I said to him, you have to give him absolute authority over your life, and you have to be willing to allow him to cut off everything of uncleanness in your life. He said, are you telling me I have to give up the clubs? I said, well, let me ask you a question. Are the clubs clean or unclean? He threw his head back kind of and he laughed and he said, they're unclean. He said, they're sleazy. I said, then is there a question about whether you should cut off the clubs and the lounges and the bars? If they're unclean, if they're sleazy, if what goes on there does not match your interest in Jesus, then shouldn't you just cut them off? Because by going there, you become unclean and sleazy. You get on the dance floor and you begin to grind against some woman you really don't know, but you're there dancing and grinding. And then you want to hook up and you want to take her home somewhere, go to her house. You want to jump in bed with her. A look of shame came over his face. Yes, Pastor. He said, well, I guess someday I'm going to have to cut off this sin. I said, well, why don't we do that right now? Why don't we kneel right here? Why don't you ask Jesus just to cut off everything that's unclean in your life? Why don't you tell Jesus that he can have full authority over you and that you're going to follow him? He thought for just a second and then he said, let's do it. So we just knelt down right there and he began to pray. A very simple, simple prayer. Lord, Lord Jesus, I cut off all uncleanness. I give you authority over my life. My heart was singing and dancing because this young man had just entered into a covenant with God to allow God to exercise his authority over him. And the authority of God means he's going to bring him face to face with Jesus. And the light of Jesus is going to shine brightly in his life. The children of Israel, they're blessed because the presence of Jesus is with them in a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. They don't need to be afraid. But they're going out into the desert. Now, I want to just say to you, please, if you're willing to get serious and you're really interested in Jesus, then he will be there for you. He will see what you're going through. He will understand the struggle of your heart. He will understand the agony of your spirit. And if instead of turning to uncleanness and instead of turning to an escape, to entertainment, if you turn to Jesus and you say to Jesus, I want you, Jesus. I'm interested in you, Jesus. I need you, Jesus. He'll come and he'll walk with you through this desert. Now the children of Israel have gone to Mount Sinai. God has come down in great power. He has spoken to them as one man speaks to another. He has pronounced his commandments. They, of course, have rebelled against God and broken the covenant. They have been forgiven. Animal sacrifices have been made and their blood has covered over the sin of the children of Israel. And finally, this journey brings them to the edge of the promised land. Now, please remember what I said as we began this broadcast. We become comfortable in the hostility of our soul against Jesus, against the God of heaven. And until a man or woman comes to terms with the hostility in their spirit toward God, and some of you might very quickly say, Pastor Ray, I'm not angry at God. I've never been angry at God. Well, I can assure you, if that's your position, that you are out of touch with the reality of your spiritual life. I have yet to ever meet a man or woman who did not harbor anger in their heart against the God of heaven, blaming him, making accusations against him for what has happened in their heart and in their life. Until we come to terms with that hostility in our spirit, until we finally begin to understand, not intellectually but internally, that Jesus is our deliverer. He rescues us. He is the light. He is not the one who brings pain into our hearts. He's not the one who brings the darkness. He is the one who brings the light. The accusations we have against God should be against the devil, because he is the one responsible for the brokenness of this world. And all of us have lived in anger and bitterness and hostility toward the God of heaven. There is an inborn, natural resistance to God. There is something that draws us to the darkness, so that we all want to go and lay our hand on the door of death. We don't want to push it open, but we want to get as close as we can to that uncleanness, to that carnality, to that wickedness of heart. Until we come to terms with that, we won't be ready to move out of the desert and go into the promised land that Jesus has for us. This broadcast is called Pilgrim's Progress. John Bunyan wrote that book and had it published in 1678, the first time. He wrote it while he was in prison. And it's the story of Christian, the allegory, the story of Christian as he makes his way from the city of destruction all the way to the celestial city. All of us are called to go on that journey. All of us are called to leave the city of destruction behind and go into what is called the wilderness. And we know the right path, because the right path is the straight path, not the crooked path. There are no shortcuts. We live a very short amount of time, and during this time that we're here on the earth, we're called to make this journey through the wilderness, and by so doing, have our sin removed, be taught how to walk in the Spirit, become friends, become worshipers of Jesus Christ, be transformed into his likeness, so that on that great day, we're welcomed into the celestial city. That's what all of this is about. It's not about getting cars and houses and money. It's not about who we can grab and bring into our sphere of influence to make us look good. It's about making the journey safely from the city of destruction to the celestial city, or to heaven. Bunyan called it the celestial city. So the children of Israel now come to the edge of Canaan land. And they decide that they will send out spies into the land. The story is found in Numbers, the 13th chapter. They send men to explore the land of Canaan, their leaders, and 12 men go forth to explore. Now, what they found was an incredible land flowing with milk and honey, a beautiful land. They found grapes, and it took two men to carry one single cluster of huge grapes. They found pomegranates and figs. They found such an incredible place. They came back, and they began to give their report, and they said to Moses in verse 27, "We went into the land to which you sent us, and it does flow with milk and honey. Here is its fruit. But the people who live there are powerful, and the cities are fortified and very large." It's reported historically that great city of Jericho had two walls. and the outside wall reached to 40 feet, and the top slanted outward to prevent people from gaining access to the city. Continuing with Scripture, we even saw descendants of Enoch there, that is, Nephilim giants. The Amalekites live in the Negev, the Hittites, Jebusites, Amorites, they all live in the hill country. The Canaanites live near the sea and along the Jordan. Then Caleb silenced the people before Moses and said, "We should go up and take possession of the land. We can certainly do it." But the men who had gone up with him said, "We can't attack these people. They're stronger than we are. They're spread among the Israelites a bad report about the land that they'd explored. They said, 'The land we explored devours those living in it. And the people we saw there of great size. We saw the Nephilim there. We seem like grasshoppers in our own eyes, and we looked the same to them.'" So now they're being invited to come out of their desert cave, but they've become comfortable in their cave. They have their food provided every day with the manna, the food of angels. They have their flocks and their herds, so they have beef to eat and they have mutton to eat. Occasionally, Jesus would even send them some chicken, their fowl. Their shoes haven't worn out. Their clothing hasn't worn out. There have been no battles except with the Amalekites that one time. They have water provided for them. They feel safe. And now they're being asked to go into the promised land and to believe that God will deliver them. Their heart is filled with unbelief. Now, let's stop for a moment. Here's the struggle that I face as a pastor. I preach about a Jesus who is the deliverer. He made atonement for our sins, so his precious blood washes our sin away. And then not only does he wash our sin away, but he lifts the sin up off our lives so that we don't continue to walk in the darkness. We don't continue walking in the drug addiction. We don't continue walking in the adultery, in the fornication. We don't continue walking in pride and anger and bitterness. We don't continue walking in jealousy and envy. We're made new. We're made clean. We don't have to walk in the sin anymore. We're refined. We're purified. We're made righteous. But all of that's a whole new deal. The children of Israel would rather stay in the desert instead of leaving their cave and becoming the army of God and taking on all the Amalekites, all of the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Nephilim, the giants. They don't want to do it. And many of you that I speak with, you're comfortable in your depression, you're comfortable in your anger, you're comfortable in the little life you live. You don't want to risk. And yet there's something in your heart that keeps calling you to come after Jesus. There's a drawing of love in your heart that says there's something more and I'm missing it. But you're so busy, you're so tied up, you're so consumed with your cave life and with the pain of your circumstances and the brokenness of your relationship. Should you risk everything? Should you risk everything? Yes. Yes, he's worth it. The blood of Jesus has the power to wash us and make us clean. We think in these tiny little boxes that we've lived in so long. I know one dear man. He has emphysema. He has a lung problem. And yet he's still smoking. Really? Why? A dear woman that I tried desperately to minister to, dying of emphysema, but will not stop smoking. That seems insane, doesn't it? I read a story about a man who was in the hospital. He was dying of emphysema. They had to tent him in the hospital bed and flow pure oxygen to him. And while he was in that tent, with that oxygen, he reached out on his bedstand and grabbed his cigarettes and a lighter and tried to smoke in that oxygen tent, and of course it exploded. It instantly killed him and caused great damage in the hospital room. Why would he do such a thing? Because he wanted his cigarette. He wanted his darkness. This is what we struggle with. The natural man is at enmity against God. We want what we want. We're afraid. And yet there is this deep calling in our heart that says, let's go and follow Jesus. And we get all of this wonderful teaching and preaching about how wonderful Jesus is and how much his grace will cover us and lift us. And then, of course, we're told by many pastors that, but Jesus will never lift you out of your sin. So just hold on to a sentimental Jesus and believe that someday you can be free. I want to tell you, my brother, my sister, Jesus is real. And he does not leave us in our sin. And after we sin against him, conviction comes to our heart, and the Holy Spirit whispers to us and says, you don't need to do that anymore. Why don't you let me take it? It's the loving voice of the Hound of Heaven who comes baying after us, constantly chasing after us, saying, will you turn now? Will you turn now? Will you let me change your heart? So the children of Israel are in the desert. They're afraid to enter the Canaan land. They're trapped. They weep before God, but they're afraid to move forward. This has been the story of their life. And now in America, we are so comfortable. We have our credit cards. We have our jobs. We have our cars and our houses. We have our children. We're so comfortable, and we fill our schedules with so many things. We're running from this place to that place, hoping that in the running, somehow our hearts will be comforted, that somehow we'll be brought into that promised land that we sense intuitively in our hearts that is there for us. And yet we're afraid. Am I talking to any of you? 877-534-0780. Do any of you identify with what I'm saying? Have you been held in that desert and yet you know there's something more for you and you hear God calling you, but you don't step into it because you're afraid, because you're too busy, because you're just not sure what will happen? Any of you feeling like that today? Or have you just settled into your desert place and it looks pretty good to you? It looks pretty comfortable to you? And maybe you'll just see what happens. Keep going down the road. Keep doing what you did before. You know the definition of insanity? To keep doing what you're doing and expect a different outcome. That's insane. If you keep doing what you're doing, you'll keep getting what you're getting. And that's where we have to make finally a decision and say, Lord, all right, I'll risk. Are you willing to risk? Are you willing to begin spending time reading the scriptures, reading Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, reading about Jesus, understanding what he did on the cross for you, not just accepting the party line of the modern church that Jesus died, took your punishment, was your substitute, and now you can continue to sin, but you've been pardoned from the effect of your sin? See, to me, that just sounds like more bondage. The reason I choose to follow Jesus is because he removes from me my sin. Not only does he forgive me, but he removes my sin so that I can walk clean before him, so that I can walk whole before him. He takes away the bitterness. He takes away the anger. He takes away the fear. The light of Jesus Christ begins to shine brightly in my life. And I'm free then to reach out, to care, to love. I'm free then to be honest about what really matters to me. And to be really honest with you, Jesus really matters to me. He is the very central focus of my heart and of my life. He's not a side interest. He's not a hobby. He's my life. His kindness and his love have overwhelmed me. His mercy has overwhelmed me. His deliverance has set my feet to dancing. Following Jesus is not boring. If following Jesus seems boring to you, it's because you followed a dead Jesus, not the Jesus of Scripture. When you begin to follow the scriptural Jesus, you've got to put your crash helmet on and put your seatbelt on because you're in for a ride. There will be nothing boring about it. Boring is staying in the cave, staying in the wilderness, not risking commitment, not risking stepping out and saying, I will follow Jesus. That's boring. Some of you today listening to this broadcast are simply, if I could put it this way, you're bored out of your gourd. Some of you are so tired of being tired. You're so exhausted from the rat race. You're saying, is this how I'm going to spend the rest of my life? Did you know life is a great adventure? You go through this wilderness, but you're not meant to stay in the wilderness. You're meant to get out of the wilderness and enter into the promised land. You're meant to be healed and restored. You're meant to be given life in its fullness. You're meant to be restored completely to the image of Jesus. I have to tell you, the image of the devil is boring. The image of the devil, the pride of life, the lust of the flesh. This is boring. Satan has such a small mind. His avenues of attack are so subtle, but they're so short of the power of Jesus sweeping into your life and turning it around and rescuing you. I hope today as you listen to this broadcast, a sense of adventure comes into your heart. A sense of joy, of the pleasure of Jesus begins to come into your heart. The devil doesn't know anything about pleasure. That word has been stolen by the devil. Pleasure for the devil is violence, mayhem, sitting before a video game, killing imaginary people. That's pleasure to the devil. Pleasure to the devil is going out and getting drunk. You know, I don't understand. Getting drunk is not pleasure. Getting drunk is stupid. Doing drugs is not pleasure. It's stupid. Zoning out so that you don't feel the pain doesn't take the pain away. I mean, do you understand? Joy, life, pleasure, fulfillment, those words the devil has tried to steal, but he can't because he can't give. He can't give these things to you. Only Jesus gives these gifts. To be washed and made clean. To be filled with adventure. To know that you're loved. To be free to speak honestly what's on your heart. To not play games. To be upfront. That's joy. That's life. And the only way you can do that is if you are set free from your sin. The only way you can walk in the pleasure of Jesus is to be washed and made clean. Now, these children of Israel, it's sad. Chapter 14 of Numbers, that night all the people of the community raised their voices and wept aloud. That sound like fun? Is that joy? No. The Israelites grumbled against Moses and Aaron, and the whole assembly said to them, If only we had died in Egypt or in this desert. Does death make you happy? They say, if only we had died in Egypt or in the desert, why is the Lord bringing us to this land only to let us fall by the sword? Our wives, our children will be taken as plunder. Wouldn't it be better for us to go back to Egypt? And they said to each other, we should choose a leader and go back to Egypt. What? What? You want to go back to your slavery? You want to go back to your numb deadness? You want to go back to being whipped? You want to go back to being ill-treated? You want your children to grow up under the slave's hand? You know, I'm sorry. I'm an American. But first, I'm a Christian. And I say, either live free or die. Either live free or die. I'm not willing to live in slavery. And in Jesus Christ, I find freedom. Freedom from sin, freedom from the devil, freedom from fear, freedom from gluttony, freedom from fornication, freedom from drugs, freedom from alcohol. I find freedom from everything that drains away the life's energy and causes us to crash and burn. I find freedom in Jesus. That's why I'm interested in Jesus. Because in his love and his mercy and his kindness, he put his arms around me and said, Ray, I love you. Come and follow me. And he grabbed me off the bottom of the barrel and he said, come. Come and follow me and I'll bring you into the promised land. I praise God for that. What joy that is. Moses and Aaron fall face down in front of the whole Israelite assembly gathered there. Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, they were two who had explored the land. They tore their clothes. They say to the entire Israelite assembly, the land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into that land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and he will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not be afraid of the people of the land. And I want to say to you, don't be afraid of your sin. Don't be afraid of failure. Risk everything. Ask Jesus to remove the sin from your life. Don't just ask him to forgive you for the past. Ask him to make now all new. Ask him if he would come and by his power completely and totally restore you to his likeness. Ask Jesus if he is willing. And he will say, yes. I'm willing to make you into a new person. I'm willing to set your feet to dancing with joy. You don't have to live in bondage anymore, but it takes courage. The Lord said to Moses, how long will these people treat me with contempt? How long will they refuse to believe in me in spite of all the miraculous signs I performed among them? How long will they treat me with contempt? Do you hear the heart of a lover who is brokenhearted that he is being rejected? Remember when Jesus came into Jerusalem at the end of his ministry and all the people were shouting and dancing and putting their cloaks down for the donkey to ride over, and they were waving the palms. It was celebrated on Palm Sunday this last Sunday. As they come in, the people are all laughing and shouting. This is their king. And Jesus sits right on the top of the hill before dipping down into Jerusalem, and he begins to weep. And the word in the Greek is not just a few tears trickling down his face. It's he began to wail. Heartbroken, gut-wrenching, sobbing. Why? Because he wanted to gather his people together like a chicken gathers the chicks under her wings and protect them. But they would have none of it. Jesus could look ahead and see that great general Titus bringing his Roman soldiers, his legions, and they were going to destroy Jerusalem. He saw the judgment that was going to come upon them. He saw the wilderness they were in, and he wanted to deliver them, and they rejected him. They turned against him. He came unto his own, and they would not receive him. The great sorrow of God's heart is when his people choose to stay in bondage and the desert and refuse to step forward into the glorious, pleasurable company of the Almighty God. So what's holding you back today? What are you afraid of? Some of you have listened for a long time to this broadcast, but you're so comfortable in your homogenized religion. You're so comfortable listening to this pastor and this pastor and that pastor, but in your heart, you don't know what to believe. You don't know what Jesus did for you on the cross. You think you're saved, but you're still walking in rebellion against him. You think you're okay, but you've been deceived. And so you neglect this great salvation that I'm speaking to you about. And you think you have to stay in the bondage of sin until you die, and that then somehow Jesus is going to take you to heaven. Not if you neglect this salvation today. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day when he's trying to say to you, come out of the desert. Come out of the bondage. Come out of the fear. Put the seatbelt on. Take a risk. Watch and see what Jesus can do in your heart and in your life. He loves you. He died for you. He made provision on the cross for you to be washed and made clean. Now please understand me. You are not saved by what Jesus Christ did on Calvary. What Jesus Christ did on Calvary only offered you the provision of a narrow gate that you could enter. He made the provision for your salvation. But now, he ministers in the heavenly tabernacle above, and he is there prepared to give you the benefits of what he did on Calvary. He is there willing to carry away your sin. He is there willing to rescue you from the dominion of darkness. He is there ready with his hand out saying, come out of the darkness into the light. Come out of the desert into the presence of God. What's holding you in that darkness? What's keeping you in bondage? Do you still have a heart that's angry? Do you still have a heart that is bitter? All of us have been mistreated. All of us have had very, very unfair things done and said to us. Are you willing to come out of that today? Are you willing to trust that Jesus wants to call you out of the desert? Are you interested in Jesus? I'm Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. You're listening to Pilgrim's Progress. Let me give you our mailing address. I would love to hear from you. The month is moving forward, and at the end of the month, we'll need to cover the cost of this broadcast. You can write to me at the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. Again, it's the National Prayer Chapel, Post Office Box 2346, Woodbridge, Virginia, 22195. You're also welcome to worship with us each Tuesday evening, a John Wesley-style class meeting. You're welcome to worship with us also on Sunday, especially this coming Sunday. Our worship service begins at 12 noon with corporate prayer. Come and join us. We meet at the All Saints Anglican Church in Woodbridge, Virginia, and the address, 14851 Gideon Drive, Woodbridge, Virginia. Go to our webpage, nationalprayerchapel.com. You'll find a quest map there, so you'll get directions that will be simple and easy to come. We're right off Route 95. Now let me take the last seconds of this broadcast to pray for you. Lord, I lift up every person listening to this broadcast today. I ask Jesus, in your mighty power, in your grace, would you give each person listening the courage to leave any bondage that they're walking in? Lord, would you come with your mighty power and quicken each with conviction by your Holy Spirit? And Lord, I pray your blessing on them today. In the name of Jesus, amen. I'm Ray Greenlee, pastor of the National Prayer Chapel. God bless you. I'll talk to you soon.
With great joy, with great joy. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory.